Just now, we recited what's called a gatha, a short verse. There are many short verses, many of these gathas in our practice. They accentuate, they make us mindful of some event that's about to take place. There's a gatha for going to the bathroom, there's a gatha for bathing, there's a gatha for before a talk, before opening the kitchen to make breakfast. So many of these short verses are intended to make us mindful of the activity that we're about to undertake. In this one, precedes the talk. An unsurpassed, penetrating, and perfect dharma is rarely met with even in 100,000 million kalpas. Now we can see and hear it, accept and maintain it. Now we unfold the meaning of the Tathagata's truth. Tathagata being a Buddha. So you can imagine that this gatha perhaps was recited in Buddha's day, before Buddha gave a talk, while the monk said, now we're about to hear something that's never been heard before. Not even 100,000 million kalpas. It's the perfect dharma. And in the generations of this practice in India, China, and Japan, they continue to say this. Even though the Buddha himself is long gone, when the teacher or the abbot, whoever it is about to give a talk, the congregation says this gatha. It is an essential element of Buddha's teaching and of Buddhism. But we need to understand its meaning in a large sense, not in, in some narrow way. In other words, this gatha about perfect dharma that's really met with is not about the lecture that's about to come up. It's not about this talk. That's a usual kind of understanding. We say something that, oh boy, this is going to be good, let's pay attention. It's not that. It's not about, you know, the talk that's coming up. And it's not just about a courtesy to the speaker. Like, oh boy, we know it's going to be great. It's not that. That's too limited an understanding of what this gatha means. This gatha about penetrating, perfect dharma rarely met with is about everything we see or hear. Everything. Every event that takes place in every moment, this gatha refers to. In other words, now we can see and hear it, accept and maintain it. That happens when we have a mind to see and hear everything without hindrance. Every activity, every relationship can be penetrating and perfect dharma if we have a mind to see and hear without hindrance. So if there is a lecture like this with speakers and listeners, or if there's any kind of event with a speaker and listeners, this gatha is true. Or we should make it true with our attitude. Which means if we can give up the idea of me, I, or we, when we can transform the idea of a personal we into a universal we, then this gatha is alive and has meaning. And there's an opportunity for this every moment. When we can do that, see, listen, without hindrance, then we have the perfect Dharma. But what do we mean? What do they mean? What did they mean? And what do we mean by, you know, perfect Dharma? And I think it's about selflessness. It's about selflessness. When we say selflessness, most people understand selflessness in some intellectual way. Oh, sure, I know what it means to be selfless. I know what it means not to be selfish. So usually people feel that they understand the concept of selflessness and how to be selfless. How to be selfless. We feel we know what that means, but because our minds are so stubborn, because we become attached to certain ideas about ourselves and certain biases, certain conditionings of our culture, we will continue to do things based on an idea of self. Unconsciously we do it. So we say, I am listening, or I am studying, or I have a question. And that kind of emphasis, that kind of idea or activity is based on the notion of self. This self. And as long as we carry around a notion of self, we can't really be selfless. We can work real hard at it and be basically an unselfish person, but to really be selfless, we have to let go of ideas of self. So when we can go beyond the ideas of speaker and me, the separation, when we can understand that all of us are just simply temporary beings, that has no permanent me, we are temporary beings that are simply relating to each other in this moment. And that our relationship is not permanent, but is constantly changing. All of our relationships are tentative. From moment to moment, the relationship is shifting very subtly and very slightly most of the time, but it is changing. And tomorrow, or even in the next minute, you will be the speaker. Not the listener. And in that next moment, I will be the listener. We're always trading places. Our relationships are always shifting. And when our mind shifts from speaker to listener, or from listener to speaker, our mind should feel this gata. So we are, as we have said a million times, innumerable times, as we study constantly, we are temporary and tentative beings. Which means we will never again meet exactly like this. So we may think, well, I'll go to the lecture again next Wednesday. It's just like last Wednesday. Not exactly so. Next week, the relationship will be different. It will be a new relationship. We cannot meet again exactly like this. Even if we relate to each other 100,000 million times. We can never meet again in just this way. Right in this moment. And when we understand that, then we know that we should not miss this meeting. We should not miss this opportunity. Not just this one here in this room, but wherever we go. You're talking with someone, you're meeting with someone, and you realize this will never happen again. Just like this. It's a rare moment. I need to take care of it. we should not miss this meeting, wherever this happens to take place. We should not take casually our meetings. We should treat each meeting, each relationship, each encounter with respect and with full attention. In other words, with selflessness. And this is the meaning of the gatha we recited. It is a very universal meaning and applies to everything we do. So usually when we meet with someone or we discuss something, our discussion is most often influenced by the idea of ourself, me, I, or this is true. The ego is always trying to exercise some control. And this happens when our view of our meeting with someone or our discussion with someone is not completely understood. If we meet with someone and think that the purpose of this meeting is for me to get my point across and to convince them of something, that's a very limited understanding of meeting with someone. That's not a complete understanding of our meeting. And this, of course, this limited understanding is why meetings and discussions often don't work. Because everybody is trying to get their own particular point across, not fully understanding the real meaning of this meeting. So that's why we have this practice, so that we can come to understand what it is that's going on between us in a true sense. What's really going on here is not just about meeting each other and getting our point across, or convincing someone. What's really going on? So, as we say, we should make our best effort to let go of notions such as me and myself. And we should be humble enough to bow, in our mind at least, to the other person. As well as to put our hands together and really bow to each other when it feels appropriate. So when you go to Japan, if you've traveled to Japan, you're very much touched by the way people in the street gassho to each other. I find it very moving that people take a brief moment, become selfless, and express their respect for each other. It's very moving. It's very touching. And then we come home and we can't do it, because it looks so strange in this culture. It's because our culture doesn't quite understand the meaning of such an activity. But we can do it, at least we can do it here. And we're here. But we can bow to each other. We can bow to people everywhere in our mind, even though we hold back on doing it this way. We can bow to each other in our mind. And when we can bow to everyone and anything, we are bowing to our true nature, to our absolute being. And then we can understand selflessness, and then we can understand interdependency. And then we know what is the real relationship that we have with each other. And that true relationship is beyond temporarily getting together. So if we talk about some Buddhist concept like interdependency, if we don't understand the teaching that everything changes, our meetings with each other may not always go well. In other words, we may wind up repeating some problem of our ego over and over if we don't understand that things change. Always change. So even if we make our best effort to have a good meeting or a good discussion, if we don't understand the tentative nature of each meeting, then how we should pay full respect to it to make it a unique jewel, we can have problems because we will remain self-centered. Tentative nature of each meeting means it's not going to come back. So let's make it a jewel while we have a chance. So interdependency means we should not ignore anything. We should not ignore anyone. We should not treat our relationships in a casual way or in an uncaring and trivial manner. In order to do that, we will have to drop off any notions we have of ourselves, of a self. We have to drop off ideas of what we want for ourselves. And these ideas come up over and over. So when we meet one another, and when we discuss something with each other, we should keep a quiet mind, not make noise with our mind, so that we can see and feel the relationship. This is how we can express our big self. This is how we can listen to each other and each other's ideas and opinions, and observe each other's ways of doing things. And we can acknowledge them and say, okay, whether they seem strange or not, whether we agree or not with the way other people do things, we observe them, we acknowledge them, and we say, okay. We say, okay. And we don't insist that our way is the correct way, that our way is the right way. In other words, we try not to be too quick to scratch the itch that comes up when somebody has an idea that seems to us a little strange or that we don't agree with, that seems to itch us in some way. We try not to scratch it. It's like when we give some instruction about Zazen to a beginner, and we talk about discomfort, and we say, well, you know, when you sit like this for a period of time, you may find a little bit of discomfort. The leg goes to sleep, or there's an itch over here, maybe there's a fly. See? And we say, try not to make that itch go away right away. See if you can sit for another 10 seconds without making a move. Don't be too quick to scratch your itch. Acknowledge it, accept it, and be patient with it. This is another way of bowing in Gassho. If you're with someone and they're talking and you feel itchy about it, if you don't try to scratch that itch right away, this is another way of bowing. Okay. If we cannot do this for each other, then it's pretty impossible for us to express ourselves. But when we can do it, when we can bow to each other in this way, then everything we do will be okay. For me, to speak this way, it was pretty easy. Well, I try to make it seem easy. But actually, to sit here and speak is never so easy, because we have to work pretty hard to avoid old habits when we're here. And when we are speaking with each other, same thing. We try to be mindful of ourselves to avoid old habits that will get in the way of free and easy speaking. But even though we have these old habits that are always lurking, I think everybody here is doing pretty well, because you are all practicing Zazen, so you're all doing pretty well. And maybe in your practice you don't know fully or exactly what you're doing. Doesn't make any difference. You're practicing. You're practicing now. You're practicing anyhow, though you may have some questions. So if some idea or emotion appears in your mind when you're sitting or when you're out in the world, you may say to yourself, "Oh, I should not have let that happen." But it's already too late. It happened. So you let it alone and let it go away by itself, and continue to come back to ourself and stay mindful to avoid that old habit. If you take this approach and you have this understanding, your practice is just fine. Even though sometimes you may say, "Oh, it's not so good." If you have this attitude, your practice is just fine. So earlier tonight we chanted the Heart Sutra, which talks about the emptiness of all things. And to practice emptiness means we don't ignore anything. We don't ignore anything. We acknowledge all things and all people equally, without attachments. When you understand your life in this way, you will understand why this practice is so important and how necessary it is to be humble in our relationships with each other.